Hello, and welcome to the Open Education Network Summit. My name is Karen Lauritsen. I'm the Publishing Director with the Open Education Network. Thank you for joining us for today's session, which is a demo of the new Open Textbook Planner. We are delighted that you could join us today, and we want to thank you for the work that you do to make education more equitable, accessible, and affordable through open education. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge that I am joining you from San Luis Obispo, California, which is the traditional, ancestral, and contemporary lands of the Northern Chumash. The Open Education Network is located at the University of Minnesota, Twin Cities, which resides on Dakota land, ceded in the treaties of 1837 and 1851. We acknowledge the places from which we gather today have complex and layered histories, and I invite you to share yours in the chat if you wish. As we begin the session, I'd like to share a few important details with you as well. The session is being recorded. The video transcripts and slides will be sent to attendees and the OEN Google group after the summit. Videos will also be posted on the Community Hub. We have allotted time at the end of today's session for questions. Please submit your questions via the Q&A feature in Zoom. While we may not have a chance to address every question, we will definitely try our best. And I see some of you are saying hello in the chat. It is enabled in this webinar, and you're invited to greet one another and also communicate with us during the session via chat. We are committed to providing a friendly, safe, and welcoming environment for all attendees. You can learn more about our community norms at z.umn.edu/summitcommunitynorms. Please join us in creating a safe and constructive space. The hashtag for the summit is OEN Summit 22. You can find us on Twitter at @OpenEd_network. So as mentioned during the summit kickoff on Monday, each of our summit sessions relates to at least one of our strategic planning action pathways. This session is focused primarily within the publishing action pathway. Our aspirational vision for publishing is to support anyone who wants to publish OER. And as part of that vision, we are actively rolling out new infrastructure, including the Open Textbook Planner, which is the focus of this session. Soon, I will hand things over to our presenter today, Dione Mentis. She is the Chief Operating Officer at the COCO Foundation. We have been working with Dione, Adam Hyde, and an advisory group to develop the Open Textbook Planner, a tool that works within the publishing platform Editoria. I'd like to take this opportunity to just say how much we appreciate everyone who's been involved in this project, and thank you for your collaboration and feedback. The inspiration for developing the Open Textbook Planner was simply knowing that writing a book is really hard work, and we felt a desire to support the hard work of authors. So we knew we wanted a tool that would help authors think about and plan their book before they started writing, a tool that would create consistent textbook structure, chapter to chapter, a tool that would prompt authors to consider pedagogical elements that could be useful in presenting learning content, and finally, a tool that would support authors in creating a template so they could focus on that learning content, not on structuring or formatting a book. So this work was funded by IMLS 3 years ago, and the grant will be formally concluding at the end of August. However, the COCO and Editoria teams are committed to continuing to develop the tool, for which we are both excited and grateful. So what you will see today is a first iteration of the tool, and we look forward to your feedback to inform future iterations. One more technical note. The Open Textbook Planner is integrated within Editoria, an open source web-based publishing platform. And in order for us to make the Open Textbook Planner available to you and your faculty to use, we're also planning to make Editoria available to you on a pilot basis, similarly to how we are running a pilot to experiment with Manifold. So I'll be sharing more details with you about that pilot soon. Now, without further ado, I will hand things over to Dione Mentis, Chief Operating Officer at the COCO Foundation, to demonstrate the Open Textbook Planner within the Editoria environment.
Thank you, Karen, for the introduction. And hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here and to have worked with Karen and Dave and the advisory group from OEN on this for the past 2 years. And I'm excited to show you what we've got so far today. My name is Dione, as Karen mentioned. I'm the Chief Operating Officer at COCO. We're also joined today by Adam Hyde. He's the founder of COCO and he's in the call today as well. So I'm going to share my screen shortly. One moment. Does everyone see my screen?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. At COCO, we specialize in building technology for organizations in the publishing ecosystem. And everything we do is open source. So I have personally worked on many, many textbooks. So it's particularly exciting for me to show you what we've got today, the Open Textbook Builder, which OEN has commissioned us to develop. I'll briefly look at some of the purpose behind the Open Textbook Builder. I'll then dive into a live demo of using the builder, both from the beginning of building a textbook template, as well as writing into the template, previewing the content and exporting the content. We'll then just give a quick overview of the current features that we have and what's up next for the textbook builder. So at the most basic level, what we're creating here is a planning tool. As I'm sure most of you are familiar with an experience of the nerve-wracking start to creating new content, whether you're an author or an editor helping a team of authors, we get to that stage where you need to answer very important questions at the beginning stages of your book to make that content flow well. The kinds of things that we look at that stage are: what content should be covered in my textbook, what information hierarchy suits my content, and which pedagogical elements are needed in my textbook. Now, of course, frequently in an educational context, a lot of this planning is led from the curricular documents. Nevertheless, the sooner we answer these types of questions in the planning stage, the better the quality of the content that we'll get out of the textbook. Another important element is promoting consistency. In any publishing tool, of course, consistency is key, but that's even more so when it's an educational product. We not only need to have consistency in the content that's being written, but also in the design that's being produced and the repeated pedagogical elements that we use to cement the learning throughout that process. From a technical perspective, consistency is also important. That allows us to create semantic HTML, which means that everything is given, everything can be written with a purpose and everything can be designed as it should be. Of course, when we put those items together, when we have consistent content, a consistent design, and consistent underlying structure, we're able to produce accessible content. That's accessible both in terms of the readability of the content and in terms of how a machine can interact with that content, how a machine can read and voice and display the content for people who may have disabilities. Consistency is one part of it, but of course we need to allow for flexibility. Any textbook that's created is never the same as how you imagined it in the beginning. Writing is not a linear process. So we need to make sure that while things are being kept consistent, we also don't want to constrain authors. And we need to allow the relevant tools to be there, whether it's something as simple as, you know, styling a word, making it bold or italics, to more complex functionality like maths equations. All of these things need to be available to an author and an authoring team so that they can produce the content that they need. So we're trying to make something that's consistent but flexible, but we also need to keep in mind that we want our books to be beautiful too. And we need to have a professional platform that can produce all of those things together. So these are just a few screenshots that I have of some content that we've worked on in the last few weeks. All of the screenshots here, just to note, have been created with content from OEN's library. So what you're seeing here is content that already exists on your site. And we've designed it using the textbook builder. So I'll just page through a few screens and then I can show you more in the actual demo. Okay, so now we will dig into the demo. I'm going to go to this page. Sorry, I just want to stop sharing my screen for a second because it's a bit difficult to get to. All right, one moment. Okay, we're back. So what you see now is the dashboard of Editoria, and I have a number of books that I've already produced. We're now going to go through the process of building a template from beginning to end. And I'm going to use a really simple example of a book to demonstrate the process from the beginning to end. I'm taking inspiration from my recent holiday, and I'm creating a book on wildcats from Africa. You'll see at the bottom here, I have a button now that says plan book. I get an introduction to the purpose of the planner and a list of the steps that I'm going to be taken through. And I start planning. Now at this point, I've given the opportunity to choose the structure of my book. I can choose a number of different options here. Essentially, it's setting the hierarchy of the book. And if I would like to, I can change this wording to something else, but I'm just going to leave it as chapter. So my book has parts, chapters, and sections. In the next step, I have the ability to write the content of my book. Now, at this point, you're really writing down the outline and you're thinking about what am I going to include in my book? So my book is pretty simple. It has three parts. First one is big cats, for example, lions. And I have another one. For example, a caracal. And the last one. Small cats. And I'm just going to give one example for now. So at the moment, I've created three parts or units, as they've been called in this example. And I can decide what I put in those. At the moment, I've just got one chapter in each. Now, at this point, I'm going to think about what I want to say about each example. For example, I might want to speak about the identification. How am I going to identify a lion from a leopard, for example? I'm going to add another section here. And I'm going to add one more. Now, in this particular example of a book, I'm creating something that has repeated sections. Of course, that's not going to be relevant to every book, but in this one it is. I want to say the same types of things about each type of cat. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to duplicate the lion. And you can see that very quickly, I've now decided on the structure of my book. I've got big cats divided into three chapters with the following sections, and I can replicate that throughout my book if I wanted to. Of course, if I want to delete anything, I can, and I can write the content as I need to, whether I'm doing that by myself or as part of an editorial group. I'm going to go to the next step. And at this point, I'm going to think about what I'm going to include in terms of pedagogical elements for each part of my book, whether it's the unit, the chapter, or the section. Now, at this stage, we have some guidance at the top about what these openers and closers are. These were developed alongside with OEN and the faculty members from the advisory group who gave input. At the moment, we have a fairly standard list of pedagogical elements. These can definitely be extended in the future. So for the time being, I'm going to say that for every chapter, I would like to have it start with an outline. And for every section, I would like to have learning objectives. And that those learning objectives will follow the main content from there. And then I'm going to end with a key terms list after my main content, key terms within that section. And at the end of each chapter, I'm going to have an activity that gives the students opportunities to practice what they've learned within the whole chapter. And just so it's not boring, let's add an image at the beginning of each chapter. And let's do the same. In fact, let's have an introduction at the beginning of each unit. So that's how I'm structuring the content. There are other options over here. I don't need to use them, but they will be available to me later on if I change my mind and want to extend the structure. Okay. At the next point, I've now seen the book has come together. I now have the entire structure where I'm seeing all of the content from my outline, as well as the pedagogical elements that I've put in. These have been consistently repeated through my textbook. So I can scan through it. You'll see that I've left some sections empty, of course. At this point, I can go ahead and finish those up if I need to. I can go back and make changes here if I want to. And eventually I'm going to look at my outline. And once I'm satisfied with it, I'm going to decide to build the book. So at this point, that's what I'm going to do. And when I press yes over here, this book is going to be built into a structure so that we have this entire template created. You'll see my book now, and it's ready to edit. And now I'm taken to the book builder page where I have a number of options available at the top to me. And I can see the entire structure of my book, where I have all of the parts or units that I created and every single chapter that I outlined. If I go into this first chapter, you'll see that I've got the template ready for me to write into. I'm in my first chapter, and I have a space to add my content opener image, which I could do from over here. And I've got a block for each element that I need to be able to write. So for example, here is my first section. And as I start writing, I would say, for example, and I could add my list items there. At this point, you'll notice that everything that was possible in the building step is available to me here. So even though I didn't decide at that point to use a summary, that I can, if I would like to, add it here. As I mentioned in the beginning, we don't want to constrain what authors and editors are able to do. We want to have all the availability ready for them. So that's a fairly simple example. Let me show you an example that of a book that we've already created. So let me go back to my books. And over here, you'll see I've got Introduction to Political Science. This again is also an Open Education Network book. So I have just looked at a book that is available in the library and created that structure. So you'll see here, I have a number of parts, and I've pretty much completed most of it, where I have chapters and sections with each one. This is obviously more complex than what I've just shown you previously. And you can see that I've taken the outline that's available. In fact, I've pretty much copied what's been done in this book. If you see, I'll zoom in. We have each chapter starting with introduction. We have the main content, and it's ending with a summary, key terms, review questions, and suggested readings. So I've stuck to what was in the example book, and I've created that structure here. I've also added an outline, introduction, and I followed that structure. So just to give you an idea of what it would look like with a more complex, realistic example, of course, you would have a longer list here. You would scan through it, make any changes that you wanted to, and then build the book. Now my book, sorry, I got that built. I must have pressed cancel, sorry. Okay, of course, in a demo, there's going to be something that goes wrong, and that's what's happening now. So this book doesn't seem to want to build for some reason. Perhaps it's because I've left some empty headings. I'm not quite sure, but we'll have to figure that out. I'm going to go back to my example that I have, where I can show you a more complete book. So over here we have an example where we've taken, again, using content from OEN's library, And we've just filled out some chapters to show you the design of those books. Here's an example that's got content in it, taken from one of Oyen's books. We're starting with an opener image, which has a caption. Then we have an outline of the content in the chapter, an introduction section, learning objectives, and then each section that follows after that, where we have learning objectives, our subsections, tables, images, all the kinds of things that you would expect to have in your book, and all the tools available at the top here that would be necessary, as I mentioned. I did want to highlight some key points where you can see that the structure of the content is being maintained. For example, you'll see that in this section, this is a heading 2. And the next heading below it, you'll see, is a heading 3. I'm also not able to make it a heading 2 because that would be structurally incorrect. And those are the kinds of things that we can do when we're consistently creating the content from the design phase all the way till the end, so we can maintain that correct structure. I want to show you just some other examples to show the kind of possibilities in this book and in other books. For example, we want to be able to do some more complex things like maths, and that's all possible. So this editor supports adding maths in LaTeX. As you can see, I can add the equation and I can edit that as I need to, and that's rendered both in the editor itself as the equation. And when you export this into PDF, you would also see the maths rendered correctly. So that's just a brief example of the more complex editing tools that would be available and are suitable for other subjects in the STEMs, for example. Okay. Before I move on to the rest of my presentation, shall I pause there and find out if there's any questions while we're on the demo section? Yeah, maybe David could let me know.
Yeah. We have a whole bunch of questions, and Adam's been doing an excellent job of keeping up with them in the chat.
Oh, great.
A few, I wonder, and he did answer this one, but I know that Shane asked about, can it handle LaTeX or mathematical equations yet? And Adam said, yes, it can handle maths, but could you dive into that a little bit more about how it handles math equations? Editorial.
Sure. No problem. So let me go back to the example where I was. I might not find it, but I can just pop it in somewhere else. So that's what I was demonstrating a moment ago over here. Let me try and zoom in if that helps. So this is my editing space, and I can write and create whatever content I need. Part of that is to be able to add math equations, such like this. This is being rendered using MathJax. MathJax is a tool that renders maths in the browser, and also in the output of the PDF, it will display correctly based on that. But from an authoring perspective, all you need to do is write LaTeX. So this sum over here, I've just copied. I don't know how to write LaTeX very well. I know the basics, but essentially all an author needs to think about is whether the content is inline or block. And if it's block like this, you simply start by adding two dollar signs and pressing enter, and that opens a space where you can write maths. And you insert LaTeX and that displays. Similarly, if you were writing inline, so it doesn't display in its own block, let me zoom in a bit. It would be $1. Sorry, computer. And a closing dollar. And that shows correctly like that. And you would also be able to edit that as you needed to. Does that answer the question?
Yep, I think that does. Thank you. Very nice demo there. One question came in that says, what's the cost of doing this through COCO?
So everything that we do is open source. There's no direct cost through us. It would depend on what the intention is. Someone could run up an instance themselves if they have the capacity to do that. Alternatively, we partner with hosting organizations. We have some preferred partners that we work with, and there would be a fee for hosting an instance and getting the support, ongoing support.
Right. So COCO doesn't, you're not a host. You don't do that.
We're not a hoster, but we work with people who host on our products, who are familiar with our technology, and who have run up a number of instances like this for us.
Right, thank you. And then the Open Education Network, Karen will talk about our plans, tentative plans for that. I mean, we're looking at, we will be getting it. We funded this work of the textbook builder part of it. And so we are gonna wanna make sure we're supporting it moving forward as well. So that's not 100% clear how that's going to happen, but we want to be working with some of these hosting companies that COCO works with to provide that service to our members. So another question, will it accept embedded HTML?
Into the editor over here?
Sure. Yep.
I don't currently at the moment know, but I'm trying to understand what the use case would be. I'm not sure that there would be a reason to, because this is generating HTML. Everything that you're seeing here is created in semantic structured HTML, right. Just to give you a demonstration. So I think it would be more important to answer, you know, what would the purpose of that be before we went down that route?
Okay. And then will it accept custom style sheets?
Yes, absolutely. So, Everything can be designed in and styled in whichever way you want it. So we have some templates being generated at the moment, specifically for OEN and anyone who's going to be using this in the network. I can show you, you know, an example of that one template we have at the moment. I'll just give you a quick preview of the content live. And we have a number of templates that are in progress and being developed. And of course, anyone could add their own templates, or we could work together to develop templates at the same time. Right. So this is just a live preview showing you, you know, the content being generated with a particular template,
right.
Just to give you an idea.
Wonderful. I think the idea about embedding HTML, I think we're getting questions about, can we embed YouTube videos, for example, or H5P learning objects, which I think you looked at in the past, right?
No, yeah, so that wouldn't be something that is possible within this environment and is also not really the best way to go, because you want to be able to have activities that are both functional in a print environment and in a web environment, and that's what we're aiming for. Whereas the HP5s, when you get a printed book, a lot of them are actually excluded because they can't be shown. So I can give you a quick example. I was going to do this in the future functionality, but I can jump to that now.
Okay.
One moment. Just trying to move this bar so I can see. Okay. So here's just an example of a work that we are busy doing at the moment. It's in a demo environment. It's not currently merged into the open textbook builder, but the intention is to include it there. So if I go to this example over here, you'll see that I have a number of options in my toolbar. And some of those options, let me just clear the screen to get a blank page. Some of those options include question types. So for example, I have multiple choice question types. Now, these you can see are working within an editor environment, exactly the same editor that you're seeing in the textbook planner. And when I create this question, it would be interactive in terms of functionality on a website, but it would also have the appropriate design and output for a printed book as well. And so we're at the moment developing questions that can be used in a multi-format environment so that they would work if your book is on a website or if your book is printed. So those are the kinds of things that we're creating at the moment. And we have different types of questions so far. We have multiple choice, two different types. We have true and false, two different types. We have an essay question. And we have fill in the gap, or fill in the blank, as Americans say, where you could write some content and that would be the answer. For example, and we have other types that are being created. For example, matching matching a particular category to something else. So option A and answer one, for example. And you would then, here's just an example of what it would look like to fill those out in an actual environment. So that's just a very brief demo of what's possible and where we are. We have about, I think it's 10 question types at the moment.
Great, great, thank you. There's a lot going on in the chat. A lot of excitement around this, Dione. Adam is doing his best to answer as many as he can in the chat. I'm going to skip over those then if Adam is responding to them. I don't think anyone answered this one yet, but it says, is it possible to see usage stats, at least number of visualizations for the book?
There's no reason why you wouldn't be able to if your book is published to a website, but we haven't gone down that road yet.
Okay. And then this is from the earlier one about embedding embedding. They said that they saw the button in the editor that looks like embedding right under the right next to the italics. There's no, go back where you were. See the under the bar at the top, there's bold italics, and then there's the little
let me just refresh this page.
Okay, yeah, there you go. See that one right there.
This is not for embedding, it's for code or so this is outputting code.
Formatting of code line. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Got it. Okay.
So you can see the difference in terms of styling over there.
Yep. Let's see. Is there a timeline for when the questions would be ready? The questions that you just demoed?
Not specifically. We have a number that are ready outside of the environment, but there is some work to do to get the stability of having multiple questions within the editing environment and testing that. So we don't have a specific timeline as yet, but we could certainly keep people updated in the community.
Great, thank you. And I know you have more that you want to talk about. So I think we've covered most of them. And yeah, Anita, you talked about math, and she did cover that, and it does handle math. Let's see. So yeah, I want to pass it back to you, Dione. And
okay. So I can certainly go over any other questions. I think that I've shown everything that I wanted to show in the demo. We looked at creating the template from the beginning stages. And building it. We looked at some examples of writing. We looked at the preview of that generated content. And we looked at, in fact, I don't think we did, but here's a PDF example of that one book that you saw. This is just an output of three different design samples, three different chapters that we took from OEN's content on the website, or in the library, I should say. Just to give you an idea of what's possible, again, this is just one template with one design, and everything here can be changed. That's the value of styling and structuring content in the correct and semantic way. You're able to have one content and multiple designs, multiple outputs. So I'll just quickly page through that.
So Dione, think what we're seeing is your Google slide.
Oh, sorry, I'm not sharing my entire screen. One moment.
Sure.
Okay, so can you see that now? I'll just go back to the beginning.
Yep. Thank you.
So as I said, these are just three design samples. Just quickly to page through the printed book, showing various features that are possible. Okay, we have a few minutes left, right? I just wanted to highlight the current features that you're seeing there. It's an entire textbook production platform where you are creating a textbook from a template builder. And then in that environment, you have a single source for your content and the possibility of multiple outputs. In that environment, you have a full suite web-based WordPress processor. You're getting all your standard functionality in terms of styling. You're also getting more complex features such as the maths. And all of that is using open standards and open source as well. And that content is then one of the ways it can be exported is through web-based PDF pagination. That's what I showed you through the demo. And again, that's all open standards. And so that design is being consistent and maintained through the entire life cycle of your content. Then we have a few things that we know we want to get done before we release to OEN so that you can all try it out. There are a few UX improvements to the builder that we want to get done, and that's what we're working on at the moment. We also have a feature where we're creating an automatically generated chapter outline. And if I can, I will just briefly demonstrate that to you. So over here, you can see Again, this is the testing environment because it's work in progress. You can see that I have some sections. Section one with a heading, section two with the heading, section three with no heading at all, just some text, and section four with a heading. Now, if you imagine that this is the chapter, or I should say, title of my chapter, and let's give it an H1. One of the pedagogical elements that we have in the planner is a chapter outline. And what we're creating at the moment is a way to automatically generate that chapter outline. So if I add a chapter outline over here, it gives me that element. And if I press this little button over here, it'll automatically add the section headings within the document. So that's automatically generating my my headings so that I can create that outline automatically. You'll see that if something is missing, it has untitled. So I can go back and check there and realize that I've forgotten a heading. So I can go and add that in right now. And if I refresh this here, you'll see that heading is added. So that's one of the features that we're working on at the moment, and that will be included in the first time we release this content. Another main thing that we are working on, as I showed you, was the multiple format question types, and we're creating a bigger library of PDF design templates using our PageJS technology so that there are multiple options available when you want to output your content. And of course, we know that there's much, much more that could be done. We would like to support more pedagogical elements so that there's wider support for different domains. Currently, anyone can create a textbook with those tools, but from the planner phase, from that early stage, we only have a limited amount of elements, and we'd like to extend that so that it's really providing far wider use for more subjects. We have export to EPUB as a standard, but we need to update that based on the functionality that we've shown here. And we could also work on publishing directly to the web or specifically to OEN library, if that were an interesting use case for you. And obviously, as you use the tool and try it out for yourself, we would love to get your feedback. Everything we do at COCO is really collaborative. We're frequently working directly with multiple organizations. And so we really do want to make sure that what we're building is as useful as it can be to the people that are using it. I think that's everything that we had planned for today. I'm not sure if we have more questions, but I just wanted to say thanks. Thank you very much to Karen and to Dave and to everyone who's attended the session. And we'd love to get your input so far and reach out at any stage.
Thanks, Dione. We have a few more questions, if that's okay, before our time is up.
Sure.
We have one here that says, did Dione mention that there were no plans to support embedding YouTube videos or H5P objects because they won't work in print?
Some of them don't work in a print environment, as I understand. And it's not our intention to support them in any case.
Okay. Is it live right now? Could I use it to create rockin' PDFs right after this session? the answer, and Adam said, talk to the OEN. So again, like COCO isn't hosting this software. They're the creators. They're creating it. But the OEN is committed to providing this, and we will have more details soon. The software isn't released yet. As soon as it is released, you'll be hearing from Karen about details about how we want to roll this out to the OEN community. So
So just to add to that, we have a meeting next week that this will be the focus of, and I've been mapping out some of the pilot parameters. So if you're really excited about using this tool, you might want to think about identifying a project, a real project that you could use in Editoria and with the Open Textbook Planner, because we will be looking for those kind of details. So I'm really excited to test this with all of you as well, and eager to get it in your hands as soon as possible.
Let's see, could it pull in an existing outline from an open textbook to get started with, rather than retyping, recreating the outline in the textbook builder?
Not in the current conceptualization that we have, but there are other ways that you could do that. For example, standard Editoria at the moment has word input, and if you could do it that way, if that was a use case.
Okay. Another comment, probably more than a question, but just someone reiterating how important embedding of H5P in YouTube videos are, and they're basically saying that without that, it's not a potential replacement for Pressbooks or what they use already.
Okay. So I didn't demonstrate the asset manager at all. There is an asset manager. At the moment, it supports images only. That could be extended to support video, audio, other types of assets. All of those things are possible, but they don't exist in that in that way yet.
Another question. Can you explain the editorial peer review process?
We don't have a specific editorial review process. If you mean how an editorial team would use the tool, that's completely customizable based on the organizations that are using it. We have a set of workflows where different roles, like an author, an editor, a proofreader, have different access and permission. But again, all of that is customizable because, as you know, most organizations have their own flow that they need to meet.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And then I would say, unless I'm missing something, most of the rest of the comments, there is some reiteration of the importance of at least of embedding. And then the rest of the comments are all, this is so cool. Awesome work, Dione, Adam, and Coco. Thank you for the presentation, everybody, and comments like that. And anybody have any final questions or comments before we wrap this session up? And then, oh, I did see Sarah's here. It says, she said she stepped in late and asked about the relationship with OEN. Again, we funded it through a grant. We're kind of the textbook builder piece of it. Editoria is an existing tool, and Coco, they are the brains behind building it and integrating those pieces. And then the OEN will be offering Editoria and the textbook builder tools to its members, and you'll be hearing more soon about that. And that's it. I think we're going to move on. The rest of them, there are a lot of kudos. So thank you, Dione.
Thank you so much. Thanks, everyone.
I will conclude with our formal concluding language for the hour that we spent together. So to reiterate, thank you, Dione. Thank you to everyone who attended. Thank you, Dave, for managing the Q&A. And thanks to Adam for being there in the chat. Thank you, community, for joining us today and in the conversation around our strategic action pathways. As we move forward with building out each pathway, we invite you to share any related projects that you might be working on or ideas that Summit has sparked for you in the community share document that Dave will be adding to the chat. This is a way for us to know what you're working on, and we very much appreciate that and love hearing about it. It can really inform the work that we do collectively. We also encourage you to keep the conversation going about today's session in the OEN Google group. Finally, just a reminder, today's session has been recorded. We'll share it with you via email and in the community hub in the coming weeks, along with slides and transcripts. So thanks to you all once again for joining the session, for your excellent questions and comments, and hope to see you soon. Bye for now.